and to the analysis of Shields and Brooks, syndicated columnist Mark Shields, New York Times columnist David Brooks. Mark, how could it be that this Massachusetts Senate race has suddenly become too close to call?
Massachusetts isn't that Democratic a state, Jim. They have 10 congressmen. They're all Democrats. They have two senators. They're both Democrats. They have 200 people in the legislature. 176 of them are Democrats, and all six constitutional officers are Democrats. So that's the question.
That's the question.
The question.
What's the answer?
Well, the answer you get, at least talking to people involved politically in Massachusetts, a lot of criticism of Martha Coakley's sitting on a non-existent lead in her campaign, that Scott Brown has run a good campaign. But underlying everything else is this sense of anger, this almost inchoate, formless fury and anger that people are feeling against Washington, against the Democrats. I mean, it seems to be the harbinger of the third election in a row where you've had the ins thrown out and the outs put in. I mean, it happened in 2006 when the Democrats took over the Congress. It happened in 2008 when the Democrats swept everything. And now the Democrats are the ins. And there's a building fury. And Scott Brown has tapped into it, and a sense of independence. And it's very much a race. The president's going in there Sunday.
He had no plans to do that until about three moments ago, right?
That's right, and which tells you the seriousness of it. But the second thing is, and for those of us who have been through campaigns, it's incredibly disruptive to have a presidential visit. Because when you're 48 hours away from the election, and you're getting your assignments about who's going to work which precinct and who's going to make what calls and drive what cars, all of a sudden a presidential visit comes in, and it just throws everything up in the air, and everybody is involved in that. It really disrupts a campaign, but they must feel the need for that energy.
How do you read what's happened?
Well, firstly, Coakley's a bad candidate. As Mark said, it's an outsider year.
A bad candidate in what way?
Well, a couple of things. One, it's an outsider year. Mm-hmm. She's running as an incumbent. Mm-hmm. She's running as an insider. That's a mistake. Then there are just the stray gaffes. She said in a famous episode, she was asked to go shake hands, and she said, why should I, you know, what would I gain by shaking hands outside of Fenway Park? Well, that's exactly what you should be doing. You're running for office. Shake some hands. Go out and meet some people. Mm-hmm. So there's that problem. Then there's the general inchoate anger in the country. But then there's opposition health care. I mean, Brown, what strikes me is he's not waging a Bill Weld Massachusetts
That's
Republican
true.
Campaign. He is waging an Idaho campaign, a Montana campaign. He's waging a very conservative campaign directly at health care. She says, you're going to kill health care. He said, yes, that's why I'm running. And so he is running a very conservative campaign. And he's drawing very even. And I, you know, as of yesterday, Obama was not going up there. Mm-hmm. And you can see why he's going.
He's made a decision a few hours ago.
He's still popular there. So Obama maybe it will help. But I would be worried of a couple things. One, it is the barrage of the insiders coming up there. And secondly, and I know this was a concern in the White House, some of the people with whom they need to win over are not core Obama people. Remember, he lost the primary there to Hillary Clinton mm-hmm. among white working class. And so they're afraid he doesn't really deliver mm-hmm. those people.
One wrinkle on the health thing, that Scott Brown has a very adroit answer, which is we in Massachusetts already have health insurance. But they do. I mean, they have universal health insurance. Mitt Romney's plan, which he owned and then disowned during his campaign for presidency.
But it's still in existence.
But that's right. It's still the law. And 96% of people in Massachusetts have health coverage. He said, why should we pay our taxes to cover people in Texas? So, I mean, there's a certain sense of pride, as well as provincialism, as well as anti-tax in his message. Republicans have already won this race, Jim. I mean, let's get that straight.
What do you mean?
I mean, because it is, here's the Democrats spending the president's capital and time, $500,000 in Massachusetts in January. I mean, what does that mean they're going to be spending in Nevada and Arkansas and Ohio and Missouri in October? I'd have to go to Ben Bernanke to underwrite it. And it's made the recruiting easier for the Republicans. The victories in New Jersey, candidate recruitment, convincing people to run for office. The victories in New Jersey and Virginia, Kevin McCarthy.
The two governors.
That's right. Kevin McCarthy is in charge of the House Republican recruitment. Called me this afternoon to tell me not only this job is easier, but that Vic Snyder, seven-term mm-hmm. Democrat from Arkansas, just announced his retirement. He's got Tim Griffin, the former U.S. attorney, running against him. I mean, he's got his...
Kind of
that's
There still is something hanging out there, because health care is really...
Healthcare is unpopular.
But it's really hanging in the balance, I think.
So it's because of the... the Republican candidate keeps saying, I'll be the 41st Republican, right. That means no 60
well,
votes for the Democrats, no health care reform.
There's the psychological aftershocks of losing in Massachusetts. And then, so now in Washington, the Democrats are saying, well, if he loses, maybe we could pass it in the lame duck session before he actually takes his seat. Or we could hold it up, we could claim a recount, ask for a recount. To me, that's crazy talk. Because if you have an earthquake, you can't just then do some monkey business and pass it in a lame duck session, a major piece of legislation.
You agree that's crazy talk,
Mark? I agree. They said that you have 10 days to certify the results.
Yeah.
I mean, the results are the results, the 10 days are not required to do it. And David's right.
If anybody tried to play games with it, they couldn't get away with it?
No, they couldn't get away with it. But this race has been nationalized. I mean, the president... is up or down vote on him whether he went there or didn't go there. So he's made the decision to go there to push all the chips into the middle of the table.
But in a word, if by chance Coakley does win and they maintain the 60 votes, is this deal today on health care reform, not today, this week on health care reform, on these so-called Cadillac plans, is that going to make it, is it going to get it through, do you think?
Yes, I think so. And I should say, I still think Coakley will win. Just at the end of the day, it's in Massachusetts. So I think it'll win. And then the deal they've struck is the deal they needed with the unions. And I have to say, I don't like the deal because I think it's a special carve out for people who happen to have union contracts. Nonetheless, it'll get through, yes.
You agree?
Yeah, I really have nothing but disdain and admiration for the person who came up with the term Cadillac plan. I mean, these are not Cadillac plans. I mean, you're talking about...
You mean the people on the other side.
I mean, the people who opposed it, they call them Cadillac plans. I mean, if you took the United States Senate, Alan Sloan makes this point, as a separate entity, 63-year-old men, the average premium for an individual would be $13,000 a year, and it'd be $32,000 for a family. That's a Cadillac plan. But because they're in the whole federal program, with everybody else's employee, it's $6,000 and $13,000. So they get a pretty good deal out of it. I mean, so workers who are older, who have tougher jobs, who picked up more, are tough, have higher premiums as a result.
Okay. Do you agree with David that Coakley's probably going to win anyhow?
I think I don't know who's going to win. The most optimistic
Democrat.
You don't
know who's going to win?
The most optimistic Democrat I talked to today said, I think Coakley's in good shape. I said, how good shape? I think the middle single digits. Special election, bad weather in January, anything can happen.
Finally, David, you wrote a column today on Haiti and what it says about global poverty. Explain your thesis.
Well, to me, this is not only a natural disaster story, it's a poverty story. We had a 7.0 magnitude earthquake in this country in 1998 or 96 in the Bay Area, very densely populated. 63 people died. Now 45,000, 50,000. So it's not only the disaster, it's the poverty, it's the bad construction, it's
maybe
the bad
140,
service.
150.
Or maybe, yeah. So that's about the social underlying factor here. And the problem is we've spent 30 years trying to use foreign aid to create economic growth and reduce poverty. We don't know how to do it. We've reduced poverty in China where we have no aid, but we have 10,000 NGOs in Haiti. We have more aid workers per capita in Haiti than in any other country just about. And yet they're doing wonderful work, but we haven't been able to build it into some comprehensive change. So to me, what this beyond the short term, in the medium term, we have to think about how do we rethink aid. How do we want to make a long-term commitment to places, to failed states like Haiti, to bring them up to the Dominican Republic, which is next door? And so I think it's worth doing, and I think this should be an occasion for that.
But we examine everything.
It really does, because we have done a lot in Haiti politically, militarily, economically, and in aid, and it hasn't done much.
How do you feel about that?
I think it's a very, very worthwhile and interesting to say that. I think the president's response was appropriate and right. I think if not us, I don't know who. We're the only people who can do it. It's something that we do and do well. It's very important that we do it and go into Haiti. And I think the fact that the sense of urgency of bringing Secretary Clinton back from her Asian trip and canceling Secretary Gates' trip to Australia, I mean, I think it shows a commitment. I hope it is as thoughtful and reasoned. But it is an opportunity to restore that country and to rebuild it. And the United States military is the de facto operating command of that country
exactly.
right now.
Right now, at this moment. David, Mark, thank you both.